Our first gospel reading for this morning comes from the book of Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 through 35. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And he came to her, he being the angel, and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called the Son of God." And the second reading is from Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising, and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to be shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there, ahead of them, went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with his Mary, Mother Mary, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then opening their treasure chest, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road.
So, as I was mentioning it during our welcome today, my brother and sister-in-law are in town with my two nieces this week for Christmas. We've been having a great time sharing the days and hours. Don't get enough of those, definitely. And I'm thankful for the season bringing them to my door. My oldest niece, Emma, is 3. So cute. And she's just starting into that why phase. You know how it goes. She asks a question about a seemingly simple thing. You give that supposedly simple answer. And then right after that, The same but much more difficult question comes, why? And of course, it can keep going from there, breaking your quick answer about eggnog down to the molecular compounds interacting in the emissions of the spectrum of visible light. Thankfully, their minds often go somewhere else at that age before digging down to subatomic science. But at the same time, I think the way they so often ask that question, why, is something beautifully basic to being human. And if you're lucky, you don't lose that curiosity, because it's what makes us unique from other animals on Earth. It helps us understand more deeply the reality we experience each moment, and ultimately fuels all worthwhile human progress and development. So I don't mind going down the rabbit hole with little Emma. I'm also thankful I never really lost that persistent why question in my own mind, now 33 years beyond the age 3. We'll be examining some of those why questions today, so let's get into it. You walk into a room. You see it's decorated lavishly with green boughs over the fireplace and a pine tree, limbs spread wide, a light in the corner. Why does this room look different? This might be the first question our minds silently ask as we enter. Because it's Christmas, and that's what we do for the holiday, would be our first, simplest answer, right? Then what question would a curious mind, a growing mind, ask in response? Again, why? What's the reason? Let's start with the foundational stuff. How about the date? Why do we celebrate Christmas on the 25th of December? We're, of course, celebrating the birth of the Christ. But if Jesus had a driver's license, next to his DOB, would it say 12/25/00? Actually, as far as our understanding goes, there would either be a blank spot or a question mark. Because biblical scholars, as of this morning, don't know the exact date Jesus was born into the world. Though many scholars speculate it might have happened sometime in March, a springtime birth, believed to have happened closer to Easter, actually, due to ancient texts indicating Mary visiting a well only pregnant women visited, preparing to give birth at that specific time of year. But even with that, we can't be sure, because our early Christian communities, the people who wrote the books of the New Testament, they just weren't too concerned with marking the specific date of Jesus' birth. Part of this was because they expected Jesus' imminent return, something they expected would happen any day after his death and resurrection. So there was no need to establish any long-term yearly celebrations. And past this, they felt if any day was to be celebrated, it would be Easter, the resurrection being of much deeper spiritual significance to them than the celebration of a birthday. December 25th is hugely important to our souls, because without a doubt, it is the time when we intentionally gather together to remember and celebrate the holy moment Jesus was born. It's a sacred and crucial part of the year for us as Christians, because it is the only time we've set aside to do this and love this, cherishing the holy minute this happened, when so much joy and hope and love came into the world with the birth of that little baby. But the date wasn't chosen because of birth records. And here's where things start coming together, where all of the eating and partying and gift-giving make an appearance around this spiritual celebration in our souls. Now, who in history normally did this kind of stuff? Which group of people was notorious for this kind of all-out crazy celebration of life? I think some of you got it. I saw some heads nod. The Romans. Yes. Those party-hardy Italian pagans. Responsible for so much of what we still do today. The date of Christmas and so many of the traditions around it actually come from their cultural celebrations for the season. Pope Julius, who served between 337 and 352 CE or AD, officially declared December 25th as the date for Christians to celebrate the birth of Christ, because the Roman celebration of a holiday called Saturnalia. Now, Saturnalia was the feast of the Roman Titan, Saturn. It began on December 17th and lasted until around the beginning of the new year. The celebration was centered on the winter solstice, the natural patterns of the movement of the sun. And December 25th was the day the sun was reborn, when the daylight hours grew longer again after having grown shorter through the days before. And just as some extra holiday FYI, our Yule log comes from similar solstice celebrations in Scandinavia. That one was a real tongue twister. I had to say that about three times when I was practicing. When people would light huge bonfires in celebration of the sun's return after so many days of darkness. But it was in this Roman celebration of Saturnalia where so many of the Christmas traditions we now share with each other began. During this holiday season, people gave gifts, dolls, to children. It was a time of goodwill toward men. All courts closed. No conviction of a crime could occur during these days. And all men, slave or free, rich or poor, were considered equal. Romans were governed only by the three laws of the priests of Cronos, the priests of Saturn, during the holiday. One was all businesses closed except bakeries and cookeries. Two, anger, resentment, and threats were strictly forbidden. And three, the third, no words were to be exchanged except those which brought lightness and happiness. Even observing with greenery was part of Saturnalia, our hanging of the greens. The boughs of evergreen trees were tied to buildings and homes, commemorating the fact that life goes on. Also, holly was given along with their gifts. Sounds wonderful. And just a little familiar, right? See, people get upset over the fact that Christmas is so often full of all of this other stuff, cluttering the true meaning of the day. But the truth is, that stuff has always been there. It's always been a part of the December celebration, because the church took it from someone else celebrating the season for a different reason. So why did all of this happen? Why did the church combine the dates? Was Christ overtaken by the Roman holiday? Or was the Roman holiday overtaken by Christ? The early church fathers intended the latter. Knowing the excitement, knowing the involvement, knowing the commotion all around them through the month of December, they wanted to connect with the larger community and bring real significance to the celebration. A theologian of the time said of the decision, "We hold this day holy, not like the pagans because of the birth of the sun, but because of he who made the sun." And of course, the Christians didn't celebrate it as a time representing the rebirth of the sun, S-U-N, but the birth of the Son of God. Appropriating the traditions and themes behind Saturnalia, they turned all this solstice celebration of moving away from darkness and into light into the same celebration, only on a spiritual level, knowing the sun, S-O-N, was coming into the world to bring an end to darkness and shine a new light on the souls of God's creation. Their hope was to bring wholeness to the holiday and bind all of these things together in the sights and the sounds of the sacred. Now, I'm not a big fan of a lot of the decisions the early church, but I don't mind this one so much, because in their decision to bring our celebration of Christ side by side with Saturnalia and join the two together as Christmas, they created a wonderful and warming connection between us all that has brought so much joy to the lives of countless people. Christmas is a time of sacred things, of warming things. Special moments we feel we want to repeat over and over again in our lives. Some weird and only our own, and some shared between us all. Just to feel that warmth and love again fill our hearts. There's the eating and drinking and giving, and there's the praying and loving and helping. All of these things, the secular and the sacred, side by side, make for moments that come together without a doubt, that's the most wonderful time of the year. So as we're sipping on eggnog in front of our Yule log under the greens which sit below a manger, let's let the love of God fill our hearts and our souls. Let's remember the life of Christ, which brought us out of the darkness and into the light. And let's love the blessings of all of these moments together, which after days of cold, brings so much warmth into this world we share. Now, when it comes to these real stories behind our rituals, there's much, much more, of course. More wise to ask about so many of our sacred and familiar traditions. Like Emma, we're just getting started, and we'll ask more later. Some harder ones. But for now, let's just take off the glasses and ease back by the fire, enjoying this moment for all they are. As we move into the season from here, let's let the Spirit of God in to fill. Remembering that whatever the reason for the season might be, we celebrate it now, today, for our love of the life which made us, our love of God, a love which came to us as a result of the life of Yeshua Bar Yosef, Jesus of Nazareth, and through his birth and each day of his life, we've come to know our God better and more intimately than ever possible before. This season, we celebrate the man who asked why, through each of the 33 years he was alive, bringing our souls into the deepest meaning of our relationship with our Maker. And for that answer to all of our questioning, we say only thank you.